Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to church. Let me begin by saying Happy Easter to all of our Orthodox friends. So Russian Orthodox or Greek Orthodox or an etc. They're celebrating Easter today. And so Svetlana greeted me today with Christos Voskresne. Something like that, right? So be sure to wish Svetlana a happy Easter today. And for the rest of us, again, welcome to worship. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, know that you are welcome here. You are loved here, and this place is your home. For those worshiping with us again online, know that you too are a part of this church. We are glad that you are tuning in, but you are a part of our family, so we encourage you to fully participate in today's worship experience, including taking some bread and some juice, having communion with us, praying with us, singing along with us. You're a part of our family as well. If you are a guest among us, please know that you are an honored guest. And so if you'll please take a presence card, there are three ways in which we offer our gifts to God in this worship experience. One is with the gift of presence. And so if you'll take a presence card in the pew backs in front of you, simply add a name and a phone and an email address. We'd love to reach out to you and thank you for being in worship with us today. And then, of course, later on in worship, we'll lift our gifts, not only of presence, but of prayer and of financial gifts as well. Now, as we prepare ourselves on this second Sunday of Easter, I invite you to stand as you are able and to greet someone around you. Let them know you're glad to see them in church this morning.
Thank you.
peace, your promises of love and grace and hope. Remind us in this time of worship that you are enough, and let us praise you in word, in song, in table, fully as we have been created to be. This we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Next several weeks, the Sunday of Pentecost is June the 9th. So during this Eastertide season, between now and June 9th, we want to lift up the joy of the Lord. And we want to invite you, if you know of a poem, a story, you seen a little funny in the newspaper or magazine, or maybe something on the news that particularly brought you joy, we invite you to send them in to Pastor Joe or I that they might be used in worship. This one brought me some joy this week. Take a look.
She's okay.
A comforting massage.
The book club loved it.
A manicure.
I've always remembered it.
Or just a walk down memory lane.
You said kill her with kindness.
This is what Harriet's Harem is all about. 21 years ago, Harriet Friedkin's friends created a caregiving group when multiple sclerosis stole Harriet's physical freedom. Every Monday through Friday, Harriet gets a visitor. But when the group heard that we were coming, they all came at the same time to tell us about their extraordinary friend. Why do you do this?
It helps her, it helps me, and it's
I think it's just good for me.
It's just a joy for me to be able to be with her.
My inspiration.
Karen Balamacy is one of the founding members.
Is this an example of that old saying, it's better to give than to receive?
Absolutely.
We both give and receive at the same time. So to me, it's a win-win situation.
Barbara Ranhand is a relatively junior member, joining just 11 years ago. She plays Sudoku with Harriet and organizes the monthly calendar.
What is it about Harriet that makes everybody want to take care of her?
It's Harriet.
I think she stimulates all of us. And I love really talking to her, but I love listening to her.
Harriet has been very helpful to me in my personal life, and whenever I can get back, as I tell her, quote unquote, Harriet, you saved my life, now you're stuck with me forever.
That is a consistent theme with this group, but Harriet says she has the better end of the deal.
What do you appreciate most?
Communication,
the talking.
Oh, yeah.
Is there some gossip that goes on?
I say there could be.
Harriet's husband, Jerry, says the harem gives her a level of support that he can't.
Do you believe that her health is better today than it would be if she did not have Harriet's harem?
Absolutely. Her mental health.
Her mental health.
Absolutely.
Really?
I think her worst times are the weekend when I'm on duty. And there's no hair here at all. She thrives on hair.
Harriet's daughters agree.
The benefits that we see in Mom, if other people could use this and also be able to duplicate it.
She doesn't think of herself as sick. She just thinks that she can't move.
Yeah.
That's the attitude that really helps.
Is that right?
It's an
inconvenience.
Yeah.
Her family and her harem say that positive outlook on life is Harriet's gift to them.
I want people getting out of this to see how wonderful my wife is.
Simple as that. You're a lucky man.
I am. This is a happy story. And I want people to understand that this is a happy story.
For CBS This Morning, Chip Reed, Potomac, Maryland.
And the church said?
Amen.
Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from the 118th book of Psalms. Now listen for the word of the Lord. The Lord is my strength and my might and has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of God. The Lord has punished me severely, but did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected, it has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God and has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, who is good, whose steadfast love endures forever. May God bless the hearing of this ancient and holy word, the word of God for the people of God. Pray with me. God eternal, we thank you for this opportunity to gather ourselves in fellowship and worship in community. As always, we recognize that you are bigger than us. So we ask that you open our eyes and our hearts to things we have not seen and to experiences we have yet to feel. Be with us in this worship experience. Lead us and guide us. And may the words of my mouth and yet the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, God, our strength, and God, our Redeemer. And the church said,
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, But this is a fairly stressful time of year. We've just finished Easter, and anyone who knows anything about church and pastors, it's a really busy time of year and might be deemed a stressful time of year. It's also the end of the term for most of our educators and students. So it's, again, a pretty stressful time of year. But the stress of pastors or students or educators doesn't just stop there. I saw a report recently that lifted a new Gallup poll. And in this Gallup poll, they surveyed over 100,000 people in over 140 countries. And they determined in this Gallup poll that Americans rank the world's most stressed out people. The most stressed Americans among us, this report went on to say, are those with lower incomes. They say money can't make you happy. I sure would like to try it, though. Anybody in here give back the lottery if you want it? Not many of us. So the lowest income Americans are the most stressed out. No surprise there. Those under 50 are the most stressed out. Those of you who have hit retirement age, I am so happy for you, yet I am envious of you. The rest of us raising children and in the rat race of working every day, that's no surprise there. And it went on to say, for those persons who disapprove of the president's job in office are also the most stressed out Americans. Did I mention to you that I was stressed? This led me to think about our lives as Americans, often called the rat race of the day-to-day life. And three stories came to mind. May I share them with you? The first story I was reminded of by a student of mine, a graduate student that I'm helping to oversee and facilitate his thesis, his master's thesis. And he reminded me of a historical figure by the name of Fannie Lou Hamer. Anyone know, ever heard that name? Oh good, I get to tell you something new today. Fannie Lou Hamer was a women's rights and civil rights activist, born in 1917. Fannie Lou Hamer was born on a plantation in Mississippi in 1917, and she was the last of 20 children. She recalled instances of racial abuses that she suffered all her life, including when her family had to move because their farm had become lucrative and there were other farmers who were jealous of them and poisoned their livestock, and all their livestock died. She goes on to recount in her life that when she attempted to vote in the 1960s, that she was beaten, shot at, and subsequently evicted from her home because of her attempt to register to vote. But most Americans, if you know anything about history, remember Fannie Lou Hamer from the 1964 Democratic National Convention. This is important because in Mississippi, African Americans were barred from voting in the primary, in a lot of southern states, actually. And these were states that were so solidly one party that if you were denied participation in the primary, guess what? Your vote really didn't matter because there was only one candidate in the main or general election. And so there was a multiracial, interracial group of people who formed an alternative party in Mississippi called the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party. And they went to the Democratic Convention of 1964 to challenge the segregated delegation that was representing their state. And after a lot of discussion and a lot of backroom meetings, her presence there and the presence of those other delegates helped to change the rules of the Democratic Party beginning in 1964. That after that, no other segregated delegation from any state would be allowed. And that was due in large part to the leader of that group, Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer, with a sixth grade education, born in 1917 on a Mississippi plantation. On the national news, her quote is now, it's famous, it's enshrined in history, where she looked into the camera and with all of her Mississippi elegance, she said, "I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired." Oh, I've got a question for us this morning, church. Has anyone in here ever been tired? Anyone in here can echo the sentiments of Fannie Lou Hamer, where you're just sick and tired of being sick and tired. Now, Fannie Lou was not physically tired, but she was emotionally tired. She was mentally drained. And thinking about the story of Fannie Lou Hamer takes me to my second story, and it is my story. In 2005, I left the illustrious city of Nashville, Arkansas, where I was living, the population of about 5,000. Big town, right? And the churches that I were pastoring, one of them in a town of less than 700. I mean, I was walking in tall cotton, right? I left there for the big city of Dallas, Texas. I had thought about all the seminaries that I wanted to attend, and I had been in ministry since I was a teenager, had been in lots of different settings, but because at the time I was in ministry in the United Methodist Church, I was told you must go to seminary. Right? And so I did, of course. I chose SMU. I came and my life turned upside down. It was the most grueling experience I've ever had. Now, I grew through it. I'm glad of the lessons I learned from it, but I would not want to relive it. Well, Ray, what happened to you? Well, in 2005, my grandmother that raised me had a brain aneurysm and lay on her deathbed and laid in a coma for over a year. After that, laid in a bedridden state for another 6.5 years.
Wow.
I was devastated. When we rushed to Little Rock, after she was airlifted to a hospital in Little Rock, and they told us that she would not make it, I literally, the only way I can explain it, I heard my heart break in my ears. I could hear it break. I was devastated. On top of that, I was going through a divorce. And I was trying to figure out how to be a parent to my young children and not be in the home. And I remember today when I told Allie, that most of you know, my daughter Allie, who's in college now, and I told her that I was moving out, and she cried and said, "But Daddy, why do you have to go?" She was maybe 5 or 6. Broke my heart. I was living in McKinney. I bought a house I could not afford, because that's what you do. You move to the suburbs and you buy a big house. And I could not afford it, because I was trying to keep up with the Joneses, see? And I was in seminary at SMU, grad school, but I was living in McKinney. Anyone know that drive? And I was in youth ministry. I was a youth minister at Vista Ridge United Methodist Church, way out on the border of Louisville and Coppell. So you think about that big, if you know anything about the geography of the Metroplex, right? You think about that drive. And I had grown up in Arkansas, Pastor Joe, and if it was 20 miles someplace, it was 20 minutes. Boy, did I have a rude awakening. That 20 miles could be an hour and a half, depending on where you were going. And this was during the time before the Sam Rayburn 121 thoroughfare was finished, and it was all traffic. And I was absolutely miserable. So I was, and then on top of that, my faith was being challenged in ways I had not expected in coming to seminary. Seminary ain't no Sunday school, let me tell you. Right? And everything that you've ever thought and wondered and things that you even hold very, very dear are now questioned and challenged. And I was at my breaking point. It was the only time in my life, church, that I considered taking my own life. I was sick and tired of being sick and tired. And in that experience, one of the voices from within me that helped me maneuver and navigate that terrain, I could hear these words from my past that said, "The joy of the Lord is your strength." I was so weak I couldn't hardly make it. And I could hear echoing in my soul, "The joy of the Lord is your strength." The joy of the Lord. And I thought, well, God, I don't feel very joyful. I don't feel really happy. So how can it be? That seems unfair. That seems like a bar set too high. How can I wrap my mind around the idea that the joy of the Lord is my strength? And that led me to my third story this morning. And it's the story of Nehemiah. because the joy of the Lord is my strength. Well, that actually is a scripture found in Nehemiah, the 8th chapter and the 10th verse, I believe. And when I began to look at the life of Nehemiah, Nehemiah was principally in charge of rebuilding Jerusalem. It was during what's called the Persian exile. And Nehemiah was a cupbearer to the king of Persia. Persia is what we most commonly think of as Iran today. He was a cupbearer. Some scholars believe he was a eunuch because he kept company with the queen, and only eunuchs were allowed to keep company with the queen if they were male. And while serving the king, Nehemiah learned that his beloved Jerusalem and his people back home were in great distress. He learned that the protective walls of Jerusalem had been broken down, and he asked the king permission to return to rebuild the city. Now, the king granted his request and sent him to the province of Judah, what we would think of as current-day Israel, and he was appointed to be the governor of Judah, which he served for 12 years. He went to rebuild the walls of the city, and while there, he did so. He fortified the city against other enemies. He helped eliminate debt, and he repopulated the city. But more important than any of that, he didn't simply find a broken city when he got to Jerusalem. He found a broken people. He found a broken people, a people distressed and deflated and defeated. And so he called the scribe Ezra to bring out their sacred text. And while gathering the assembly of all the tribes and families, the 8th chapter of Nehemiah records this. Then all the people gathered as one person in the town square in the front of the water gate and asked the scholar Ezra to bring the book of the revelation of Moses that God had commanded for Israel. So Ezra, the priest, brought the revelation to the congregation, which was made up of both men and women, everyone capable of understanding. It was the first day of the 7th month. He read it facing the town square at the water gate, and from early dawn until noon. Now, you think I preach a long time. Are you listening to this? From early dawn until noon, he read from the book. And when he read from the book, all who could understand it, all the people listened, and they were all ears to the book of the Revelation. Ezra opened the book, and every eye was on him. He was standing on the raised platform. And as he opened the book, everyone stood, and then Ezra praised God, the great God, and all the people responded, "Oh, yes, yes," with hands raised high. And then they fell to their knees in worship of God, their faces to the ground. Nehemiah, the governor, along with Ezra, the priest and scholar, and the Levites who were teaching the people, said to all the people, "This day is holy to God, your God. Don't weep and carry on." They said this because all the people were weeping as they heard the words of the revelation. Nehemiah continued, "Go home and prepare a feast, holiday food and drink, and share it with those who don't have anything. This day is holy to God. Don't feel bad." Another translation says, "Don't be weary, for the joy of God is your strength." Oh, amen, church. Yes, 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 yes. Don't give up. Don't be weary in well-doing. God has not forgotten us. God has not forsaken us. God is with us. See, Nehemiah was a leader of the Jewish people, but this story also reminds me of another Jewish leader by the name of Jesus. And it's in the life and love of Jesus that we are reminded of this great promise. Frederick Buechner, I believe is how you pronounce his name, a novelist, a poet, also a Presbyterian minister and theologian, says this. This quote was lifted to me by one of my colleagues this week. He's quoted as saying, "Resurrection means that the worst thing is never the last thing." Oh, you missed a good place to say amen. Resurrection means that the worst thing is never the last thing. That is the meaning of resurrection. That is the lesson of our faith. Through the power of Christ's resurrection, we are offered new life, new opportunities, new mercies, and new paths forward. This is the center and the source of our joy. We just have to open our hearts and our minds and reach out to receive it. See, joy is different than happiness. Happiness means you got to have something happening. But joy bubbles up from the inside. It springs up from the soil of God's love, and it is watered by our gratitude. Joy is present despite our circumstances. It offers us strength to endure any test. But Ray, you say to me, I don't feel very joyful. How do I get it? You get it the same way the folks in Nehemiah's time got it. If you look back at the story, what did they do? They gathered in community. Reminds me of another scripture that says, forsake not the assembling of thyselves together, right? This is a benefit of being in Sunday school and vacation Bible school all these years, right? All these scriptures are logged in here somewhere. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. They gathered with their community. That's how they felt the joy of the Lord. They worshiped God. Sometimes I think we forget the blessing of worship. We want to kind of skip past it and get to other things, right? But oh, it's the blessing of worship. The blessing of lifting your hands or your head or your heart or your voice or all of the above to God. After they worshiped, they offered thanks for what is, not regret over what could have been. Remember, they're in exile still. They're in oppression by an oppressive government. Yet they offered thanks. And then what does it say they did? They got them something to eat and drink. They had a good meal. And they were merry. And they shared what they had with those who did not have enough. That's the recipe. Not rocket science. That's the recipe. In moments when we are weak, in moments in which we are distressed, in moments in which we are sick and tired of being sick and tired, the joy of God is our strength. It is what pushes us the next mile of the way. It's what helps us not give up. It's what helps us see another day when family drama has us distressed, or children aren't doing what we need them to do, or spousal conflict has us troubled, or something on the news has us tied up in knots, whatever it may be. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And in the words of the psalmist read this morning, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Thank you. come to this time in our service where we give the best things that we have. We give our presence, we give our prayers, and we give the gifts that, as a response to God's great and gracious love, you know, it is true, isn't it, that, as Pastor Ray said, joy is different than happiness, that joy is deep within. And I think of the woman in our first lesson this morning, in the moment of joy, that joy emanated from her core of her being. And when that happens, it makes it possible for us to be generous in many, many ways, to be generous with our time, to be generous with our love, and to be generous with our gifts. And we hope that you will participate in the three offerings we take this morning: your presence, your prayer requests, and your gifts that help us to be a church where people can come and learn what joy is really all about. So thank you. Thank you for your gifts this morning and all that you are. Let us receive our offering.
Oh,
family and friends and family of choice after they had celebrated the high holy day of their people. Jesus does a remarkable thing. He changes the text of the evening and uses simple gifts, the simplest gifts at the table, the leftover bread, the leftover wine, and he makes a new covenant. The remarkable thing about what he does is that he is facing dire circumstances and has to know that. But on this night, he thinks of us. He chooses to think of us. And so, taking those simple gifts, he took bread and gave thanks to God and blessed the bread and broke the bread and gave it to those present and said, "Take and eat, for this will be life for you, my life, broken open for you." And after supper, Jesus took the cup and, blessing it, gave thanks to God and gave it to those present and said, "Drink from this, all of you." He didn't say, "Drink from this, some of you." He said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the new covenant poured out in my life. I do this so that you will know every time you eat this bread and drink from this cup that nothing in all the world, nothing done by you, nothing done to you could ever separate you from God's love." And then he only asked one thing of us. Do this often. And remember, you are now the body, one body. Amen. Will you extend your hand in an upward motion? In a gesture of blessing and receiving, and let us bless this meal together. Come, Holy Spirit, now upon these gifts of grape and grain, make them be for us the very life and love of Jesus, that we may in turn be the life and love of Jesus to the world. Amen. I would invite those who are helping to serve to come forward. I want to remind you that this table is prepared by the people of this church, but is open to anyone who is here. You don't have to be a member of this church or any church. You don't even have to know what you believe. You can just come and share in the mystery that is met at this table. And we especially welcome our children to come and to partake. And so come now as the ushers guide you, and let us share in the feast that is prepared for us. Amen. Logan, this is to remind you how much Jesus loves you. Heather, this is the life and love of Jesus. Scott, the life and love of Jesus. Holy God, we give you thanks and praise that once again you have met us at this table, and that through the mystery of this feast of your love, we are filled up, that we might fill up the world with your love. Amen. Well, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. We're so very blessed by your presence. It's been a great day of worship, and I hope that something in this service reached down deep and pulled that joy up from the depths of your soul that Ray was talking about earlier today in his sermon. So, a couple of announcements before we depart. There will be fellowship time in the fellowship hall, and following the fellowship time, there is a listening session on unification, and that is for the Central Church folks only. And so, if you are part of Central, if you're worshiping as Central, if you're a member of Central, go on down to the fellowship hall. You're going to have some food and a meeting. So, and then if you're part of New Church or you're a guest here, you're invited. We're going to go to lunch down the street, Inwood's right over here to the west, and we're going to go up Inwood just past Forest. There's a shopping center with a Starbucks, and there's a place called the Village Burger Bar. And because the weather's pretty, we can sit outside. So come and be a part of a Dutch Street lunch, and we'll just enjoy the day. And then coming up, this coming Saturday, we are engaged with a ministry toward the homeless called The Bridge, and they serve the homeless meals each day. And we've signed up to serve on Saturday, this coming Saturday, May the 4th. May the 4th be with you. So we need two more people to sign up, and a bunch of us will go, and then we'll go out to dinner after we've served dinner. And so if you can do that, talk to Heather Zink, and I don't see her in here right now, but talk to Scott. if you can't find Heather, talk to Scott. In that order, yeah. And then we have two more listening sessions that will be joint listening sessions on May the 5th following worship and on May the 12th. So if you can't stay today, there's going to be other opportunities, or you stay today and then you come back a couple of more times and gives us all a chance to talk together as we move forward. And then the last little announcement I have is that there's some Easter lilies out there in the narthex. And if you would like one or two, please feel free to take them. Here's what I happen to know because of my good friend Angie Latimer, that you let them bloom out and then you plant them in the ground and then they die and then they come back just like Jesus did. You know, so just get you an Easter lily and plant it in your flower bed, and sometimes they bloom before Easter, sometimes they bloom after Easter, kind of depending on, you know, Easter is a movable feast. So, but they bloom. They come back and they bloom, so get you one. You hear? Okay, let us rise as we are able, and Ray's going to pray us out of here for our blessing.
May the power of Christ's resurrection
and the blooming power of Easter lilies be in your soul today. May you rise even after many deaths. No matter what this world throws at you, may you have strength for the journey. Let us sing.
Of darkness.